which of the following patients should be seen first? We have to see somebody first. So something is wrong. So we look at the first one, a client with a productive cough, fever, and saturation of 94% on 2 liters. Making a diagnosis with multiple symptoms in the case form. So we have a patient who has productive cough, he has fever and saturation of 94%. What do you think? I have cough and I have temperature, fever, and I'm studying this. Something is affecting my lung and this is happening. This is what we call pneumonia. But does pneumonia, having pneumonia, make you a buzzwords? You see, I did not put it in the, on the B-sharp chat. There's nothing telling me the patient distressed. His breathing is being affected. There's nothing. Therefore, this is not a B-sharp issue. It's an expected finding. If you have pneumonia, you have fever, and SATs will be 94, close to normal. A client with pneumonia receiving levofloxacin. Even if you don't know what levofloxacin is, you know something, it has to be antibiotic because it's pneumonia, you get antibiotic. So if I have pneumonia and I have antibiotic, what do you think is going on? Nothing. I'm being treated with the pneumonia with antibiotic. Therefore, this is not a problem. So it's a breathing problem, but it's not a B-sharp problem. A client with pneumothorax and tidling in the water seal chamber. I have a video on chest tubes, so you should check it out. The chest tube has three chambers, okay? The drainage system, the suction system, and the water seal chamber. In the water seal chamber, you see tidling. What is tidling? It shows you that the tube is patent. The chest tube is patent. When patient take a deep breath, there's a movement of water through the tube itself and the water seal chamber, and it go up and down, up and down. You can check if this is okay by listening to the patient. It tell you they're breathing. That's why you see up and down movement of water. Therefore, when you see that in the water seal chamber, that means everything is good. So it's not a B-sharp problem. A client with paradoxical, so another buzzwords, movement, chest movement, and a saturation of 94. Your attendant should be going up right now. I have paradoxical movement. My SAT is low. Well, what is paradoxical movement of the chest? That means when they take a deep breath, usually when you take a deep breath, your chest move out. And when you breathe in, we breathe out, your chest move in. These people, when they take a deep breath, the chest doesn't move out because he has had multiple rib fractures broken in one side consecutively. And therefore, that area, when they take a deep breath, that chest, instead of rising, it depresses down. So that's paradoxical chest movement. And therefore, this is a problem. And his SAT is also going down. Number one problem with this problem is they get pneumonia. Bad one, not a single one. Bad pneumonia, and they end up being intubated and it becomes a problem. And so these patients, I need to see him. Because I need the number one treatment for this multiple. Usually they have rib fractures, epidural. This is not a patient you be nice to them and give, you are not nice to them, you give them Tylenol. No, this patient will need a PCA. Okay, they will need a PCA or epidural to manage their pain. So that is content level right there. Okay. Last one, a client with the left femur fracture and petechia on the chest. Buzzwords should be ringing in your ear. The buzzwords is what made up of the B-sharp. So I have left femur fracture and a petechia on the chest. Even though there's no petechia on that, but on the B-sharp, there's indication of something going on. This is the form of DVT, okay? But we don't call it DVT, we call it different. That's why there's DVT on the B shot. This is fat emboli, okay? This is fat emboli, and which has led to pulmonary embolism. So this is on the B sharp, but you don't see it like that. I don't write it particularly, otherwise I have to write every word. But there's embolism, wherever it come from, it doesn't matter. If it's a catheter embolism, the same thing, patient IV dislodged, or you have air embolism through the catheter going to the patient lung, you can see all of them is a breathing problem. It causes sudden chest pain and decompensation of the patient. So, you know, you have different kind of embolism. You can have a septic embolism. That means an infection of your IV. It can be air embolism, air going through the IV. It can be catheter itself moving through the vein into your heart. All of them. It can be fat embolism, somebody who have femur fracture, long bone fracture, or you can have thrombotic embolism. So this is all one, even though it's not there. So you have to think clinically and critically. And that is what the NCLEX is about. That's why I try to give you guys content level to let you think. You can't pass this test without a very good and foundation of content. Don't just do questions like that. Don't do questions. You end up memorizing questions. Please don't do that. So this patient need to be seen first. So that's what we have. And the last one. Which of the following patients should be seen first? The same technique we're going to use. We're going to use being B sharp. A client with CHF, okay? Congestive heart failure with the pink fluid sputum. Well, I don't see pink fluid sputum, but that's another word of calling something called pulmonary edema. So this patient has pulmonary edema. From CHF, what is pulmonary edema? That means the lung is being drowned in water. So they have too much fluid that the lung is being drowned, and then the vessels are rupturing. And so when they cough, there's blood in it. You got to save them. It's a breathing problem. It's not an airway, it's a breathing problem, but it's still a priority. I'm choosing this patient. A client with right femur fracture with acute sharp chest pain. This is another way of reframing the other one I did. So they can just trick you, change so many things in the words, but they're telling you the same thing. The NCLEX don't have any new question. Take it from me. They have no new question under the sun. They're the same old questions, but they change one word from it, and then they modify it such that they change the answers a little bit. So don't try to memorize the answer. But the same concept, we are talking about fat embolism from long bone fracture. They can tell you they have petechia. They can tell you they have just chest pain because they have femur fracture. They can tell you they have what? Confusion is another presentation. Okay. Long bone and then sudden onset of confusion, you should worry about fat embolism. So this patient gets seen first. A client with left pneumothorax and a tracheal deviation. So pneumothorax, if this is the lung, okay, and this is the trachea. So this is the trachea and the lung is here. And this is the chest wall. Pneumothorax means you have air all over here. Okay. There's air outside the lung. It shouldn't be there. Usually air is supposed to be inside. And they have pushed the lung away. And the trachea is moved away. So tracheal deviation. This is a pulmonary breathing problem, but then is leading to airway issue now. So be careful when you have pneumothorax and a tracheal depression. There's a name for it. It's called tension pneumothorax. So there's tension physiology. So tension pneumothorax, tension physiology of that. And that's a problem. And that this patient need to be seen first. They will need needle decompression in the second intercostal space of the mid-clavicular line, or fourth and fifth intercostal space, anterior axillary line, using minimum of 16 gauge needle. So 16, 14 is fine. Content level question. And that's the information I've given you. The treatment, even though we're doing this, I've given you tension pneumothorax, what it looked like, and how to manage it with needle decompression, immediate needle decompression. Number four, a client with obstructive sleep apnea requiring morphine for pain. So this is a tricky one, okay? You have OSA. This is why you got to put your thinking hat on. OSA patient requiring morphine. You don't just go and give them the morphine. These patients, their respiratory drive is all depending on them being awake. So they have apneic episodes multiple times. More than 50% of their sleep is made up of apneic episode. So that's another thing you have to know in terms of questions if they ask you. So more than 50%. And then therefore, they have something we call stop bank. And that is how you can make, if they ask you to make a diagnosis, then you do what we call stop, okay? Stop bank. That is the way to diagnose this sleep apnea. And what does that mean? The S means somebody see you that you're snoring, your wife know you snore all the time. T, you tired during the day or when you wake up. O, somebody observe you also that you have apneic episode. And then P is your blood pressure. So your blood pressure is high, at least stage one hypertension. And then B is BMI. If your BMI is greater than 35, so that's the criteria. And A is age. You got to be more than 50 years old. And then the N, it talks about the neck. So the way I remember is minimum of 16. So 16 inches. So that is like 40 centimeters. Somebody's neck is like 16. That's huge neck. And then unfortunately, it's male. So G is the gender. So this male versus female. So male sex has more diagnosis of that. So that is obstructive sleep apnea. I'm giving you content at the same time. So these are the features you can see to diagnose it. If you see it in a SATA form, just write stop bank. Snoring, they tired. They be observed. They have a blood pressure problem. The BMI is getting the one. This is the one they trick you. BMI is greater than 35. That one you have to remember that number. And then the age greater than 50 is very important. And then the N is the neck circumference. Is the bang that is the odd one, greater than 16, and of course male sex, because the being awake is all help with their respiratory drive. You cannot give them morphine just like that. If they ask for morphine, go and sex them and make sure they really, really need it. Because when you give it to them, you have to watch them like a hawk. So OSA people don't just get medication. This is a tricky one. But this is respiratory drive going down. That's a breathing problem. That's how they can ask you. And the last one, a client with left pleural effusion and decreased breath sound. Think about it. The same example we have here, but this is fluid. This is all fluid. So fluid here. If you listen to the lung here, you expect the breath sound to be decreased, right? Is that a surprise to you that there's a lot of fluid in the chest? And when you listen to the lung, all you hear is decreased breath sound. No, that is expected. You shouldn't worry about it. That is not being sharp. There's nothing in the B sharp that say effusion alone. When you have infusion, you got to think about other things. Effusion with complete decompression of the heart, or you have tamponade, all of them is very important. So you got to think. It's not compressing. It just decreased breath sound because of what it is. And this question, the answer choice usually give it away. They don't. There's no change in tone, test taking strategy. There's no change in tone or negative or positive. He has the monotony way of the monotony way of way the way the question was written. The client with left pleuro effusion and decreased breath sound. There's no high and low tone. Therefore, this is unexpected. Don't use the that's the trick too. Don't never use the first aspect of the question, especially who do you see as the most important? Because that first portion, they're going to give you diagnosis. You see all the first portion, you have CHF, femur fracture, pneumothorax, sleep apnea, and left pleural effusion. They will give you the diagnosis. They have to give you the diagnosis. Then they tell you the signs and symptoms, content, pathophysiology. You see, keep on coming back. Signs and symptoms. So when they give you this, look at what is happening. Pleural effusion and decreased breath sound. Well, patient is not in distress. Nothing in that telling me. And therefore, this is an expected finding. I have to be sharp in the breathing buzzwords. This is my method, a versatile tools that can solve most problems in prioritization.